ESPN Radio 94.1, your home for Old Dominion basketball. And our next guest is a rather decorated one, a two-time Olympic gold medalist, two-time WNBA champ, and three-time All-Star during her accomplished pro career. We're talking about the head women's basketball coach of Old Dominion University, her team at 8-2 on the year, six consecutive wins. We say hello to Coach Delisha Milton-Jones. Coach, how's the holiday shopping going?
The holiday shopping is non-existent at this point. The only thing I have in my buggy is hopeful wins in the near future.
Wow, I was bringing you on here to give me advice to what I should give my family members and relatives because none of them are listening right now. So you have nothing for me there.
Nothing for you, nothing. It's just strictly basketball right now. Right. I'm looking for dubs.
Dubs. Well, W's are nice to have for sure. That means I'll have to make the mad gift card dash coming up in 3 or 4 days in between our trips to Appalachian State and Temple. Tell us, the audience out there that haven't watched this team or some that have, 8-2, six straight wins over St. Joe's, Texas Tech, and Stetson in the Van Chancellor Classic before returning to Virginia soil and beating Bowie State, William & Mary, and Norfolk State. What's been the difference here from the 2-2 beginning to this six straight win streak?
Well, I think the clear difference is our consistency on the defensive end. We found a way to ramp things up, and we put together consecutive stops. We've gone on defensive runs, and that has allowed us to go on 16-0 runs offensively, 17 and 18-0 runs respectively. And if not for that, I don't know what our squad would look like, but I'm very proud of the fact that we have hung our hat and our efforts on the defensive end.
And one of the things we brought up on this show a few nights ago, even on our pregame, our broadcast, postgame shows, is that another thing that's got to be a comforting fact is so many more players at your disposal than a season ago. You're not scrambling for bodies as you were in year one, right?
No, I definitely am not. The pandemic did a number on us, obviously, when you only have like 8-9 players on a 15-woman roster. But this year we definitely have a full roster, so I'm able to throw out many different combinations to get whatever it is that we need.
What we're seeing in sports, to follow up on that, with the COVID protocols, more at the professional ranks here in the last few days with the news with the NBA and the NFL, but it's even hit college basketball on the men and women's side with cases surging all across the country. Give us your feeling on things, and have you had to bring it up to your squad and make them even more aware of what's going on, taking the proper safety measures here in this precious time?
No doubt. You know, even though we are post the pandemic, we are still living within it, within the remnants of it. And I constantly tell them, now is not the time to relax, because there are so many different variants that are popping up on a daily basis. There are still individuals out there who have made their own individual choices of not getting vaccinated. So the percentages are never going to be in our favor as a society. And if we want to have a chance at playing this game that we all love, we have to safeguard ourselves and continue to live within our bubble, even though that bubble has changed shape a little bit because we have a little bit more freedom to do certain things. But we still have to be conscious of the fact that any wrong move, being in the wrong place at the wrong time, not safeguarding yourself, can really hinder the rest of our season.
You were an accomplished player, as we brought up in our open here. Is the mindset with how you handle this different from the player and coach's perspective, or does it absolutely have to be aligned on the same page for things to go off the right way?
It definitely has to be within the same alignment. I don't think there's much difference in the mindset of the player in comparison to the coach. You know, if you want to have an opportunity to continue to play, you have to go about your daily lives a certain type of way, conscious of what you're doing, because what you do can directly affect the masses. The masses meaning the people within the community of ODU or the sanctity of our locker room. So you always have to think of the next man in every situation.
Talking with Delisha Milton-Jones, she's the head women's basketball coach at Old Dominion University, surging at six straight wins, 8-2 on the year. Our guest here on the 757 at 6 on ESPN Radio 94.1, which will bring you Monarchs women's basketball coming up on Saturday with a pregame show, the Toyota pregame show, 1:30 airtime coming up against Appalachian State with the tip at 2 o'clock from Boone, North Carolina. And Coach, I'm going to throw a curveball your way here. What's the best thing about being 8-2, and what's the worst thing about being 8-2?
Oh, wow, that's a good question. Let's see, the best thing about being 8-2 is that you're on the winning side of things. The worst thing is that sometimes when you're winning like this, you can almost get set in your ways. Although our ways have been successful, each team presents a different challenge for us. So you can't rest on your laurels and think that the work you put in the game before is enough to get you through for the game ahead of you. So I've been losing a lot of sleep because I've been watching even more film, trying to figure out all the different angles that our opponents could try to attack us within, as well as dissecting ourselves to make sure that I've covered every basis to make sure that we are on point and clicking on all cylinders heading into our competition.
You're 10 games through this season. There's about a good, I don't know, it's 20, 25 games. Could be more than that if you make a deep run in the tournament and make it to the NCAA tournament with this squad, which certainly has the talent to do so. Anything surprised you 10 games through?
I think the thing that has surprised me is how quickly we respond to the sense of urgency, the call of the sense of urgency that was needed when we lost to George Washington and then to VCU. We knew that that was not the identifiable factor that we wanted to present to the world when it comes to ODU women's basketball. And we had some nice conversations with one another. We got rather intimate and reflective at the same time. And we said that the only thing that we can control in this scenario night in and night out is our focus and our effort on the defensive end. And everyone has kind of taken that onus upon themselves to not be the one that causes us to either have a letdown defensively or not be the one communicating. And we all want to be the ones. We're striving to be the ones to help spark a run for us on the defensive end.
Look at the numbers, and you've got six different players with double-figure steals with Asia Wayne, Iggy Allen, Amari Young, Mariah Adams, who was missing in the game against VCU. We've seen what an impact she makes when she's on the floor. Kay Clark and Asia Hudson off the bench. And then even a local product with double-figure blocks already, 15 rejections, and Brianna Jackson from Princess Anne High in Virginia Beach, the transfer from Miami. So you're seeing those players really apply themselves possession by possession on the defensive end.
Yes, and the beautiful thing about it is every individual is understanding how they can impart their magic on our defensive play within the scheme, within the game. You know, Brianna, she may not be able to showcase the agility and the athleticism that Amari Young does to be able to front defenders on the post, switch out on guards in pick and roll situations, and get her hands on steals, deflections that lead to steals. Brianna understands she just needs to be a big presence in the paint, wall up, and then she could come across and get a block every now and then, and she can be an enforcer for us in the paint. So now that everyone's understanding how they can find their niche within our defensive efforts, now we're starting to put some good runs together.
Well, it's interesting because I think we've all kind of labeled the start of the year. You have at least two players that are player of the year material with Asia Wayne, who just recently went over 1,000 career points down there in the Van Chancellor Classic in Katy, Texas, and also Iggy Allen, the newcomer from Florida Atlantic. But there's other nights when we've seen other players step up into the fold, whether it might be a Kay Clark, it might be an Amara Young, it might be a fill-in-the-blank, who could be your MVP on that given night. Do you feel that same way?
I definitely do. You never know who is going to be the individual that steps up. And the most valuable thing that we do on the offensive end of the floor is allowing the ball to find the open player. And in order for that to be able to take place, the ball has to move. We have too much talent, too many threats on the floor for the ball to be stuck in one person's hand. It's more difficult for our opponents to guard us collectively rather than it is for them to guard us individually. So we want to put a huge amount of pressure on our opponents by moving the ball, moving our bodies, playing with spacing and pace, and we allow the game to be able to come to each individual rather than someone trying to hunt shots.
You got an opponent coming up here this weekend in Appalachian State who's 6-5 on the year. They've played a couple of ACC teams in North Carolina and Duke, and then not long after that you'll be taking on Temple just a few days later. First up with Appy State, what do you see about them on film as you try to get to 9-2 on the year?
Well, with App State, you know, they're a type of team, they will mix their defenses up, and they can definitely do some damage in transition. But more than that, they do damage defensively. Where they may not have the solidarity that a team would hope to have on the offensive end. They basically are a mirror image of us. They are very disruptive on the defensive end, whether they're in their man-to-man or they're in their zone defensive plays. And for us, we're going to have to come out and make sure that we're poised and we don't allow them to make us play faster than we would like to. And we just have to take our time and read the situation and make the appropriate plays. Now, when we're guarding them, we have to be very solid defensively because they do some things as a team to where they play on the bad habits that people universally have on the defensive end. So we have to apply basic basketball principles when guarding them.
And lastly, Coach, it's interesting to look at the Conference USA overall standings. Nobody's began conference play. You'll do that at the end of the month here. But Charlotte was the preseason pick. They're one of just three teams below the 500 mark, as there's 14 schools, 11, 500 or better here. How much have you kind of followed, even though you're focused on these two opponents out of conference before you begin CUSA play here, with the league's success here and out of conference games, including your own?
Well, no disrespect to anyone else in Conference USA, but our main focus is us. But I have been able to catch some games that Charlotte has played in, and they played some very good opponents. And they've fallen short on the winning side a few times, but that still does not negate the fact that they're a very good team that is well coached. So when conference play starts, we know that that is a new season, and everyone has a clean slate, so we cannot rest on the work that was done in non-conference. Non-conference is designed to get everyone ready for conference play. And I expect Charlotte to definitely still be at the top of the pack once conference play begins.
That is Coach Delisha Milton-Jones of your Old Dominion Monarchs. Her team 8-2 on the year, six straight wins, going to try to make it 7 when they go to Appalachian State coming up on Saturday, then 8 when they take on Temple with a noon tip on Wednesday. So, Coach, good luck this weekend on the wins. I'll see you then, and you'll have a day or two to get Christmas shopping done, hopefully when you're 10-2 when you return, all right?
Yes, sir. Thank you so much, and happy holidays.
Happy holidays to you. Delisha Milton-Jones with us here on ESPN Radio 94.1. Your home for the Monarchs, doing a great job there in just her second year at the helm, as the team is starting to really click here before they return to Chartway Arena on Thursday, December the 30th, to take on Florida International, then a New Year's Day game against the Owls of FAU, that being Florida Atlantic University.